You know, joined by Professor Jay Batongbacal. He's the director of the UP Institute for Maritime Affairs and Law of the Sea. Good morning, Attorney Jay, and thank you for joining us again on the program.
Hi, good morning, Christian, and to all our viewers. Good morning.
Okay, let's talk about the situation at the Julian Felipe Reef, which is contained or located well within the exclusive economic zone of the Philippines. Recently, you wrote a paper warning that this could be President Rodrigo Duterte's Scarborough Shoal. What exactly did you mean by that? Let's explain this to the public.
Well, basically, the situation has a lot of parallels with what happened with Mischief Reef and Scarborough Shoal. You had an initial activity, which was Chinese fishermen coming in, conducting various activities on that reef. And then they are, this is followed by or accompanied by the exclusion of Filipino fishermen from that area. And then they eventually tighten that grip on that shoal, and we end up losing control of the reef. No? In the case of Mischief Reef, it was underscored by the establishment of initially what were just huts that they called fishermen's shelters, but now it has turned into a massive artificial island. While on Scarborough Shoal, what has happened, of course, is that our people are unable to regain access to their fishing grounds inside the shoal, and even government vessels have not been able to approach that area. So that that might happen again, this time with respect to Whitsun Reef, and I believe that that's why the government was very concerned when they saw these, this massive fleet just anchored at the reef.
Now, going by the lessons or the experience in 2012 at the Scarborough Shoal, what should the Philippines do now? Because you know that after that incident in 2012, the Philippines filed a case before the Permanent Court of Arbitration, and we won that in 2016. But right now, seeing what's happening now at Whitsun Reef, and based on the lessons in 2012, how should the government approach this now?
Well, right now, there is still an opportunity, a chance for a different outcome because the government acted early enough this time, immediately upon sighting these massive numbers of Chinese vessels. At least it cast a light on what was going on. And as we've seen, no, after that attention, no, the vessels have dispersed and their numbers have been reduced at the very least. No? So there is still at least a chance that all of the vessels can leave this reef. So the government's action of filing protests is the correct move. And right now, its announced decision to file a protest every day as well is also consistent with that. What remains really is the constant surveillance of that on that area so that we can know whatever activity they are undertaking there if they do not leave, no? And the constant interaction with China asking them to leave is also necessary until they fully disperse and leave our exclusive economic zone.
Should they also send certain naval assets in the area?
I think that at this point, naval assets are not yet necessary given that you have a reduction in their presence already. And we have been able to send at least our Coast Guard to that area. We have not sighted any China Coast Guard or PLA Navy vessels yet accompanying these vessels. So there would be no need yet for more robust presence, no? But nonetheless, the surveillance flights are necessary so that we can continue to monitor whether the these vessels really are dispersing and leaving our exclusive economic zone.
Okay, now let's talk about the importance of making sure that the Chinese won't seize control of the Whitsun Reef or of the Julian Felipe Reef. How important is this for the Philippines?
Well, it's very important because after all, the Whitsun Reef is part of our exclusive economic zone, and it is also more or less in the middle of the Spratly Island group in that area. So it's a rather strategic location. It is just south of southeast of the Pagasa Island and below our string of island outposts in that region. No? It is a very strategic area for the Chinese, especially when you consider that it is also in the center, more or less, of this triangle of large military bases that they have constructed. Mm. And around this area, this around its own reef itself, no, you have several smaller Chinese artificial islands that host their radars and surveillance and other equipment, no? Which would be protected by those three large bases. It could be an ideal place actually for some kind of headquarters to control all of these military bases that they have in that area. And then Whitsun Reef itself, no, if they were to take it and gain control and occupy that area, they would therefore also gain control of the entire Union Banks, of which Whitsun Reef is a part. No? They already have two artificial islands on Union Banks, one in Johnson South Reef and another in Mackinnon Reef. And Whitsun Reef is the last piece of that that puzzle, shall we say, no, by which they will be able to control a large area again of the sea. And that would be equivalent to the loss of a large portion of our EEZ again.
Mm. And this also explains probably, or most likely, why the other players are very much concerned about this. We hear a lot of more countries speaking out very strongly against what the Chinese vessels are doing there near Whitsun Reef, right?
Yes, yes. Because all the other countries have also been observing how China has been making gains in the South China Sea and in the West Philippine Sea. And they're very much aware that China does use its fishermen and its maritime militia to eat away, you know, at the exclusive economic zones and continental shelves of the surrounding Southeast Asian states. We've already seen it happen. They've tried this tactic in several other places. Well, aside from Mischief Reef and Scarborough Shoal, they've, for example, taken more or less continuous presence, established a continuous presence over James Shoal on the Malaysian side. You know, and James Shoal is a completely underwater feature, and yet they're now there continuously, and they're presenting it as this, their southern border. And they've also been trying this tactic elsewhere. No? So the fact that it's been done before has already led the international community to fully support the Philippines in its move to try to prevent that from happening again.
Okay. Now, the option of going to the United Nations, is that a good option at this time? And if I may add, let's also talk about how Vietnam has been dealing with similar actions by China, and what can be drawn from that particular experience by Vietnam?
Well, with respect to the UN, I think all diplomatic options are open. It only remains for the government to make sure that a particular action, such as going to the UN, achieves a particular purpose. No? So it's not, most people assume, no, might assume, because most people might assume that just by going to the UN and firing a protest there, something will immediately happen, or that means that the UN will take action. It's not that simple. No? So doing so, making such a protest in the UN might be for a different purpose, such as calling the attention of the UN members to what is happening and adding more leverage, no? Diplomatic leverage to our position. With respect to Vietnam, Vietnam deals with Chinese incursions very differently. No? They've reached the point where you have Vietnamese ships often engaging in dangerous maneuvers against Chinese vessels, no? And there have been collisions, no? And they've had instances where it's almost like an unarmed battle between Vietnamese ships and Chinese ships, no? Banging against each other. And there have been incidents where Vietnamese vessels have sunk because of that, no? So I think that Vietnam, when it comes to the presence of Chinese vessels, especially in waters in the Gulf of Tonkin, no, they react very differently. They really send their own contingent of Vietnamese fishing vessels to literally confront the Chinese fishing vessels.
Okay, Professor Jay Batongbacal, thank you very much for joining us on the program, sir.
Welcome, Christian, and good morning to all.